brought to you by Penguin.
Money Box, written and read by me, Paul Lewis. Introduction. This book is about how to get more money, how to stop wasting money, and how to use the money you have better. It covers help from the government or local council, emergency help from charities and others, using your skills to make money for yourself, stopping paying for daft things, and making the money you have work for you, not someone else. Pay less tax to the state, beat the banks at their own game, and treat the finance industry not like a friend, but more like a vague acquaintance you don't really trust, but have to see from time to time, and who always makes you pay for the drinks. It will arm you with the knowledge you need, and warn you about things that can leap up and bite you, as well, of course, as those that stealthily drain your money away. How to use this audio book? It's arranged in a new way, like your life. It begins when you're born and ends when, well, you know when. Of course, some things like fraud, investing, falling in love can happen at any age, so they get their own special interludes. Early chapters about finance for babies and children are aimed at their parents. Sorry, little ones, you are allowed to read them too, so you know what they're planning for you. And occasionally, topics spill over from one age to the other, each with its own spin. There'll be some duplication because some things are so important they need saying twice, at least. But broadly, the chapters follow you through life and explain what you need to know or do in the seven ages of people. And at the end of the book, that is, there's a quick reminder about the things you should have done earlier and a handy wormhole to crawl back in time to do them before it's too late. Handy references to further help, organisations, maybe even the odd book, are scattered throughout, but they're brought together in a PDF that you can download with this audio book. And to keep you completely up to date, I'm on Twitter, at Paul Lewis Money, with my daily news about finance and other things. A quick word about places. The UK is England, Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, and I always put them in order of population size. Great Britain is England, Scotland and Wales. Generally, laws and legal procedures are the same in England and Wales, though in some matters, the health service, local government and now a few benefits issues, Wales is growing apart thanks to devolution. Money matters are slightly different in Northern Ireland, which of course is not a country. My Northern Irish colleagues tell me it's more a province. And several key money facts, including tax and benefits, are often very different in Scotland, as the Scottish government flexes its devolution muscles. Long before that, when the English and Scottish governments merged in 1707, Scotland sensibly kept its own education and legal systems, which accounts for some of the differences in student finance and things like wills and divorce law. If I don't mention differences, I'm referring to the whole of the UK, but don't confuse that with the British Isles, which includes the Isle of Man and the Channel Islands, principally, of course, Jersey and Guernsey. They all have separate governments with their own parliaments. These make their own laws and have their own taxes, benefits and financial regulators. They are not covered in this book. But the Isle of Wight and the Scilly Isles are part of the UK, as are Shetland and Orkney, and the Isle of Lewis, where, before you ask, I don't come from. Disclaimer. Everything in this book I believed to be correct when I wrote it. Then I checked and made any necessary changes. The great people at Penguin Random House have been all over it too and found other points to correct or clarify or delete. But there may be things we all missed or which have changed in ways we didn't expect. Or I may just have expressed something so badly that you misunderstood it. For all of that, I apologise and take full responsibility. Be aware that benefits normally increase each April. This book uses the rates for 2022-23. They should be higher in 2023-24, but may not rise fully with inflation. Tax allowances normally also change then. As I write the final draft of this book, there is a freeze on most tax allowances with no changes due until April 2026. But that's a political decision, and as this book was being finalised, the UK was plunged into a period of political and economic turmoil. The country had 3 prime ministers and 4 chancellors in as many months. Plans for taxes, benefits and other policies changed, changed back and changed again. As a result of this chaos, the interest rates paid on savings accounts and charged on mortgages shot up to their highest levels for 15 years. To keep up with those unprecedented times, numerous amendments to the book were made right up to the day of printing at the end of October. So if the details of tax and benefits are different from April 2023 to what was expected, or the rates I've quoted on savings or mortgages look silly, forgive me. They were correct at the end of October 2022, just as the new Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, was appointed. All the rest of the book remains as true as ever. Oh, and although I do give advice, quite a lot of it, it's not regulated advice, and you should always check it before doing anything that could cost you money. I cannot take any responsibility for money you lose as a result of doing what I suggest, but I will take great joy in money you save or make by living your life in the way I set out, from naught to 99 and beyond. Chapter 1. Birth and Before. If you sat down and worked out the cost of a baby before you got pregnant, well, you'd probably choose to remain childless. Child Poverty Action Group reckoned in 2021 that it would cost a couple £161,000 to raise their firstborn to adulthood. It would cost a lone parent £194,000. Happily, the financial toll is rarely at the forefront of your mind when you make a baby, which is probably just as well. But as you start bringing them up, you soon realise the cost. Budgeting for a baby. There are things you can do to reduce the outlay. Choose second-hand, not babies, of course, equipment, where you can, given that babies use highly specialised bits of kit for just a few months before graduating to the next expensive step of development. Purchasing baby bundles, a collection of second-hand clothes, is another way to reduce costs. And if you do buy new, then sell stuff on when it's past its use-by size. As with most things financial, I suggest setting up a spreadsheet. I really don't believe you can understand things you can't measure or count, and enter all those essentials so you know what costs to expect at the end of pregnancy without the frills. And a spreadsheet is just a good way to make lists and organise them, even if you don't use its ability to do sums. All this big spending on the smallest person in the house comes just at the time when earnings might well be sacrificed to give you bonding time or just enough sleep. You need to make sure you get as much money as you're entitled to receive. Pregnancy support. This century, much of the government support for pregnant women has been cut or ended. But here's a quick guide to the remnants. If you're claiming universal credit, see Chapter 5 for more on universal credit, or other means-tested benefits, then you may be able to get a healthy start card, which you can use to buy things like fruit, milk, vegetables or beans. And you can also get free vitamins. Great news, because those cost a lot of money and they're good for pregnant women and their babies. See healthystart.nhs.uk. In England, Wales and Northern Ireland, a helpful £500 can be had from the Sure Start maternity grant. There are 2 conditions. You only get it for your first child. If you already have children under 16, forget it, though there are exceptions. For example, if second time around you find yourself expecting twins. And you, or your partner if you have one, must get a means-tested benefit, such as universal credit. And I'll do a little list of those benefits in a moment. TurnToUs.org.uk has a great guide to what you can get. Search Sure Start Grant. Scotland. Things are better in Scotland. I'm tempted to abbreviate that sentence in future to TABIS, because they usually are. There, you get a best start grant of £642.35 for your first child, and twins get one each, and £321.20 for others. Apply from 24 weeks pregnant to when the babe is 6 months old. There are further payments at 2 and school age. More on those later. Patients, we're before birth here. Now, here's that list of means-tested benefits. These are related to your income and circumstances. Universal credit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.